Hey everyone, my name is Kyle Worley and I'm here with Antonia Bastian, my colleague and sister. Hey Antonia.
Hello.
Hey, thank you for jumping on. And we wanted to take a moment today, or maybe a few moments. We're just honestly, Antonia and I are just about to have a conversation in public view. So it could be 5 minutes, it could be 20 minutes. Antonia and I get to talk about big ideas and things that matter to us a lot. And we both like to talk through things. And as I was thinking through Martin Luther King Jr. Day, I thought, you know, I could write an article. We've written a lot of articles on race in the last year. I figured, well, you know, we could repost some things. We could link some helpful resources, and we'll do that. But more than that, I just wanted to talk about the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And really, it may feel like, well, why would you do that? Is it just because today is like culturally a day? Well, it's actually not the case. We actually have a scriptural precedent for doing exactly what we're about to do. Hebrews 13:7 says, remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God, consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. And so when we do this, whether we're remembering Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. or we're remembering the legacy of John Calvin, or we're remembering the influence of the church fathers like Augustine or Athanasius, when we look back, we're just doing a work that scripture calls us to do. We're reflecting on the life and legacy of the men and women who have come before, who feared the Lord and sought to communicate the fear of the Lord in righteousness. That's what we're doing. And so that's why we're doing it today. And there's a lot that can be said. And I think that oftentimes it's easy to kind of look back on the legacy of Dr. King and imagine that the way that kind of culturally we feel about Dr. King today is how people viewed him then. That is not the case. We now it's kind of become culturally acceptable to see him as this beloved figure and champion. But it's easy to forget that at the time of Dr. King's murder in 1968, 75% of Americans disapproved of his views and activities. 75%. I mean, Antonia, does that number surprise you when you look back on it and you think about just kind of his life and legacy and how we think about him culturally?
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know that it surprises me. I mean, when I spent some time yesterday just looking over some of his, you know, most infamous speeches. And so today I have my I Am a Man mug from the 1968 sanitation strikers, worker strike in Memphis. And so I think I had the opportunity to go to the Civil Rights Museum in Memphis. And I think for me, that was a couple years ago for the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's assassination. And I think that's where I probably felt that 75%, just in walking through and seeing what the civil rights participants went through, and so and the hostility that they endured and what it took for their endurance of courage. So that's not surprising. I do think it's important though to consider how we do look back. I mean, it was not until recently that I learned how long it took Coretta Scott King to advocate for Martin Luther King Jr. Day. So even though it's something that we take for granted and that's been part of our, you know, imagination for a while, it's actually decently recent in comparison with just his legacy and the depth of what he contributed to American culture.
Right. And, you know, we think about his voice, you know, we think about, can you talk about early and late Dr. King? And when we think about Dr. King, we almost uniformly remember him for some of his most like golden moments. Like the I Have a Dream speech is certainly probably the one that's most forefront. If you came through an American history class, if you got a thimble of Dr. King's life and leadership and what he said, that's probably what was in that thimble. But he had been advocating not just against injustice or inequity or the injustice of racial discrimination, but as his kind of platform grew, he began to speak directly to a number of issues. I mean, you show that mug from the sanitation worker strike, you know, in Memphis, he's really advocating at the time for a living wage, for like fair labor laws, particularly for Black sanitation workers in Memphis. But his plea for human dignity was growing over the course of his life and leadership. You think about labor injustice, you think about nuclear proliferation, you think about systematized poverty. We often think about like lunch countertops, bathrooms, and buses.
Yes.
That may have been where it began, but it was growing. His view of human dignity, his view of how justice should impact the society, it was spreading even over the course of his life and leadership. And so I think You know, if I was imagining Dr. King speaking today, I don't think that he'd be an Instagram influencer posting, you know, cool pictures of himself on beaches with pithy quotes. He'd probably be advocating against mass incarceration, which at a incredible rate disproportionately impacts Black men in the life of this country. He'd be arguing against mandatory minimums. He'd be talking to congressmen and senators about three strike laws. He'd be advocating for a living wage. These are things that he would be talking about because those were the kinds of things he was talking about, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, no, I think you're exactly right. It is easy to, in our, to be nostalgic and to narrow his influence when, yeah, to your point earlier about just imitating and reflecting on the model of leadership that you offered, that something that I've been struck by just as I've, again, been reflecting is the comprehensive nature, to your point, of human dignity and right. just the ability to articulate the doctrine of image bearing and its implications. And so in it, reminded of Jesus and the way that we see in the Gospels and he is bringing forth good news and also moving towards people in their embodied distress. And yep. so that's something that has been encouraging, a reminder to me even in this season, that serve a God who hears about both.
Yeah, absolutely. And listen, Antonia and I, our hope out of you watching this is not that you become a Dr. King scholar. We really just want to invite you into having your imagination shaped in the way that his imagination had been shaped. Because I'll tell you, if you've ever heard a speech or if you've ever read something that he wrote, you will quickly realize this is a man who had deeply internalized the witness of scripture, like at a high volume. Like there are times when he's talking and he's not even directly quoting scripture, but the way that he's talking is showing indirectly that he had just kind of soaked in it, particularly the minor prophets. And so that's not crazy. The man was a pastor before he was an activist, and he was a theologian. He had received his PhD in systematic theology from Boston University. So he had done the work, so to speak, in terms of sitting in the Bible, having to walk ordinary men and women through scriptural truth in the face of a kind of a cultural crisis. And so maybe to kind of bring it down on the bottom level for us, Antonia has a book that she's going to read some portions from, and it's geared towards kids. But I'll tell you, I've looked over the portions she's going to read, and I can tell you there's stuff in there that I did not know about. And so this could be a good time. Maybe you've been watching this and you've been wondering, how can I talk to my kids today about Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.? Well, you could just sit them down real quick and show them, hey, here's a little story. And we'll share a little bit about that life and legacy. I promise it'll be helpful for you to consider, and I know that it will be helpful for your kids. And so, Antonia, you want to jump into that?
Absolutely. All right. This book is called I Am Martin Luther King Jr., and it's from a series called Ordinary People Change the World. I am Martin Luther King Jr. When I was little, I used to get into a lot of accidents. One day, my little brother hit me in the head with a baseball bat. Two other times, I mistakenly got knocked over by a car. Another day, I turned over our banister, then bounced through an open door into the basement. Even before I could read, I knew that I liked words and books. And my dad always talked about how I kept a lot of books around me. I used to tell my parents, when I grow up, I'm going to get me some big words. There is power in words. Big words were in my future. When I was 6 years old, one of my best friends was a boy whose father owned a store across the street. My friend was white and I was black. It didn't matter to us. We would play games and have fun together. But when we started going to school, everything changed. He went to a school where all the kids were white, and I went to a school where everyone was black. Soon after, he told me, "I can't play with you anymore." "Why?" I asked. "My dad said so. He doesn't want us being friends." "But why? You're one of my best friends, aren't you?" I didn't understand. It didn't make sense. At dinner, my parents explained, It's because you're black and he's white. I was so mad that day. How could someone treat me differently just because of the color of my skin? I wanted to hate my friend and his father. But my parents told me to do the opposite, that I should love my friend, even though he hurt me. They taught me that it's better to have more love in your life than hate. Then my mother taught me one of the most important lessons of all. You are as good as anyone. You must never feel that you are less than anyone. I wanted to believe it, but every day I saw the opposite. But what can I do about it? At the age of 15, I started college. By 19, I became a minister and entered seminary school to study religion. And over the years, I read the works of all sorts of men and women who advocated for a peaceful protest, nonviolent protest. It was a lesson I wanted to share with everyone. Was it easy? Absolutely not. During one protest in Birmingham, Alabama, the police again arrested me and locked me in a dark jail cell that only had one window. But more change was coming. Freedom was contagious. In the summer of 1963, an estimated 1 million Americans held their own protests in cities across the country. A man named A. Philip Randolph suggested a massive march. If we march together peacefully, they won't be able to ignore us. Together, we can convince Congress and the president to pass laws so that no one in America can be treated differently based on skin color. I like that idea. Where should we have it? There's only one place. People came from almost every state. They came in nearly every form of transportation. They even took off work and did not get paid just to be there. Old people, young people, black people, white people, even children. They came all to Washington, D.C., gathering in a righteous army. Why? Because they wanted a change, and they knew the surest way to change the world is to stand together. I'm happy to join you with you today in what will go down in history as the greatest demonstration for freedom in the history of our nation. On August 28th, 1963, I stood at the podium and spoke what some later called my biggest words of all. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but the content of their character. I have a dream that one day little black boys and black girls will be able to join hands with little white boys and white girls as sisters and brothers. Let freedom ring from every mountaintop. Let freedom ring. In my life, people tried to tell me I wasn't as good as they were because of the color of my skin. When someone hurts you like that, it can be tempting to hurt them back. You must refuse. When someone shows you hate, show them love. When someone shows you violence, show them kindness. To reach our goals, we must walk the path of peace. We must lock arms with our brothers and sisters. We must march together. When we do, our voices will be heard and freedom will ring. I am Martin Luther King Jr. I stand for peace. I stand for justice. I stand to help others. I stand as proof that no matter how hard the struggle, we must fight for what is right and work to change what is wrong. Whatever struggle you face, no matter how hard it gets, you must always move forward. I am proof of this. If we rise up, if we stand together, if we remain united, nothing can stop our dream. The
Thank you, Antonia.
You're so welcome.
I love hearing that story. And I think that, it's one of the things that I think is most striking to me about a day like today and reflecting on the life and legacy of Dr. King is that oftentimes it is really easy for us to forget that the fight for justice, the fight for peace has always been upstream in the life of the world. It has always been accompanied by struggle. And I was reflecting on the letter written from a Birmingham jail cell. It was mentioned in the book that he was there and as part of a boycott, and he was thrown in a jail cell. And from that jail, he wrote a letter, and that letter was a response. We think about that letter oftentimes as kind of just having a universal audience, and certainly it has reached a
Sure.
universal audience, but it had an initial audience. And that initial audience was from colleagues, white pastors, who had written a letter to Dr. King in jail because he's been fighting injustice in a nonviolent way. And they pretty much tell him, hey, why don't you hold on? Why don't you just wait a little longer? Quit taking direct action. And he writes a letter in response to them. And there's going to be a lot of folks today that are going to share some snippets from that letter. You're going to see it all over social media. But there's some things that are not going to be shared from that letter, and I think those might be worth reflecting on a little bit. So I've just pulled a few selections from them, and I'm just going to read them real quick. A few just thoughts that really struck me as worthy of reflection for today. King tells these pastors, he says, "Listen, I'm in Birmingham because injustice is here." And he roots this in the prophets of the Bible. He says, just as the prophets of the 8th century BC left their villages and carried their thus saith the Lord far beyond the boundaries of their hometowns, just as the Apostle Paul left his village of Tarsus and carried the gospel of Jesus Christ to the far corners of the Greco-Roman world, so I am compelled to carry the gospel of freedom beyond my hometown. Like Paul, I must constantly respond to the Macedonian call for aid. I mean, this is the opening volley of the letter, and you can immediately see Dr. King. He's not rooting what he's doing in some sort of cultural moment. He's not rooting it in some sort of secular ideology. He's immediately saying, I left Atlanta. I left Atlanta to come here because injustice is here. And I can't preach in Atlanta about injustice. And then when there's a call to answer injustice with action, say, yeah, that's really for somebody else to do. So he's saying, listen, the prophets left, they went, they followed the call of the Lord, and so I have to here as well. And he begins to tell them, he says, listen, I know that you're telling me to hold on, but he says, listen, I have yet to engage in a campaign that was well-timed in the view of those who have not suffered unduly from the disease of segregation. So essentially saying, for years now, I have heard the word wait. It rings in the ear of every Negro with piercing familiarity. This wait has almost always meant never. We must come to see with one of our distinguished jurists that justice too long delayed is justice denied. And that's striking, oh, because this is a quote that today is going to be everywhere, but the context of it is essentially saying this. I know for many of you who are very comfortable with the way that things are, it seems like, why don't we just wait a little longer? This is all going to shake out. Look at the progress we've made. But like Esau Macaulay said in an article published in Christianity Today, Dr. King wasn't measuring the 60s against the 20s. He wasn't saying, look at how good it has become for Black Americans in light of where we've come from. He was measuring his present moment against the biblical idea of righteousness. And Antonia, when you hear that, it resonates with you immediately, right? But why? Like, why does that seem compelling? Because I feel like we fall into that temptation all the time, right? I mean, in a number of issues, but particularly when we think about justice, it's very easy for us to go kind of look back across historically and be like, look, we're making progress, as opposed to saying, this is the Bible's picture of a just and peaceful kingdom, and we're falling short, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think, so right now we are about to kick off Life of Abraham study, and something that has been compelling to me just since sitting in the Genesis narrative is just the reminder of what it means to be an image bearer
Right.
and to image God. There are many, many ways to go with this, but something that stood out is to know when to respond, when to partner with God in creating, and knowing when to trust, and also knowing when to stop striving for what is only the Lord's to do. And so I say that because there is a tension there, and we are always kind of a bent towards which one we're going to fall, either hyperactivity or passivity, right? And so, yeah, but the core, what I'm tying this back to Dr. King, because he really embodies what, just as I was reflecting, just a prophetic selflessness to say it's not about, you know, I mean, I can't, even just reading, you know, his last speech and before, in the day before he's assassinated, and just, he's talking about, you know, getting on a plane and they had to stop the plane because they needed to search for bombs and his house is a bomb. And so you're like, man, this man has been through so much, and yet it's compelled by this prophetic vision, not of the 20s versus 60s, but of Genesis 1 and 2, and compelled by the coming day of Revelation 21 and 22. And so, yeah, there's just a beauty in that, and we long to, in our right minds, in repentance, we do long and can allow for the tension of the of imaging a God who is faithful. Yeah, and so I think that prophetic nature, though, of being able to see, but also the selflessness of being able to, of laying down your life. And so at the very end of his last speech, you know, it says, you know, he says, like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place, but I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And that's something that we, you know, to your point about the quotes that we'll put on things, and, you know, even Philippians 2, like, lay down your life, you know, and it's like, he laid down his life, and there is something, that we do long for. We do long to be part of something that is worth our lives. And I think, now one of the bigger temptations is to rightly discern what is worth our lives, because we are giving our lives away to something, whether or not, you know, or what we're giving our lives away for is in accordance with God's will. But at the same time, you know, he is rooted in the presence and in the glory of God, which you talked about yesterday in your sermon. And so that's his, like, this last, I mean, his last words, essentially his public words are, I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. And so, you know, advocating and living a life of selflessness is costly. And so it has to be rooted in the glory of God, and being able to anchor our fears and anxieties, and even, you know, at times the potential loss of life, in the bigger narrative.
Yeah, no, gosh, I mean, that's well said. You know, and I think when we think, and when I think particularly in as a white pastor, I mean, I would have been on the receiving end of this letter. I mean, just like in terms of who got this letter, it was people like me. Mm-hmm. People like me received this letter. And he says something in here that cuts me to the heart, and I'm sure cut those pastors he was addressing to the heart. He says, shallow understanding from people of goodwill is more frustrating than an absolute misunderstanding from people of ill will. Lukewarm acceptance is much more bewildering than outright rejection. And he keeps pushing here. He says, when I was suddenly catapulted into the leadership of the bus protest in Montgomery, Alabama a few years ago, I felt we would be supported by the white church. I felt that the white ministers, priests, and rabbis of the South would be among our strongest allies. Instead, some have been outright opponents, refusing to understand the freedom movement, misrepresenting its leaders. And then he says this, all too many others have been more cautious than courageous and have remained silent behind the anesthetizing security of stained glass windows.
Oof. Also, can you point out the beauty of wordsmithing?
Oh,
like,
gosh, yeah,
a lot of, that's a different conversation.
Yeah, he was a master of words. But when he hits you with, or like the quote from the letter that I read yesterday in the sermon, where he talks about the early church was a small number of people that were too God intoxicated to be astronomically intimidated. You're like, come on, man. Oof. but you know, I think when I read this, particularly that last thing, all too many others have been more cautious than courageous, have remained silent behind the anesthetizing security of stained glass windows. What's he pulling out here is this, that it has been true throughout history that there are, that in any period of history, there is a group of people who are not experiencing the benefits of justice and peace that should characterize the coming of God's kingdom. I mean, that has been true. because it's a broken world and broken systems and broken societies, and that every kind of empire or civilization has done that, and they've had some slant. And so it's not uniquely true of the American experience, but in American history and American experience, that group of people historically are Black men and women. There's just, you don't need the data for that. You don't need the history, but the data and the history are there. You just need scripture's witness that everything in the world is broken, including the systems of human hands, and that it usually angles in a very culturally situated way. And in the life of our country, that is how it's played out. And Dr. King is addressing with full force here that it is very easy for those who receive the most comfort and the most security and the most safety and the most abundance from a society to essentially be numb to the injustices of those who don't. And he's addressing these pastors, essentially saying the church should be disturbed and unsettled by this. Not just the Black church, but the church of God in Jesus Christ should be unsettled by this. And yet he's very honest about his disappointment that that's not been the case, that it wasn't the case in Birmingham. It wasn't the case in Selma or Montgomery. It wasn't the case in Albany. It wasn't the case basically anywhere he went. And by the end of his life, the overwhelming majority of white Americans disapproved of him. So even at the end of his life, he had actually lost more approval than in 63 when he writes the letter. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you just think, what happened? Well, what happened is when a moral prophet begins to put their finger on the sore spots, mm-hmm. people are going to recoil from that.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and I think from a I don't want to say different perspective, but from a different perspective of, you know, you're receiving that letter and considering as a white pastor, and I'm reading and considering, you know, all these years later in different ways as a Black woman, a believer, and what you just said there, that tension of, you know, those who in some ways or in all the ways ought to be the most compelled by this vision for justice restoration are the most being resistant to it. And I think when I talk to other Black men and women and people of color, and especially over the last year and last few years, I mean, that has been the crux of a lot of suffering. And so in terms of, okay, how do I navigate living out a radical call of discipleship, following Jesus, and the tension of those who share similar faith, who are often, whether aware or not, right, in contrast to that. And so I think that's something that's another reason I'm grateful to be reflecting on Dr. King's, you know, legacy, is because he offers that middle way that I think a lot of Black Christians in particular are wrestling with. And there's a weariness to, oh man, we see it, and yet you are my brothers and sisters. So how do you navigate the tension of that without moving towards cynicism or a hardened heart or all the things that you're trying to undo in the world around you?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, before we give you some resources that we think would be good for you to engage with this week, I mean, if you're looking to maybe take one more step beyond this and you haven't, you don't know where to start, I'll tell you, there is a bevy of free resources. Bevy. Maybe not a word. That may be a $10 word. There's a lot of free resources out there, and we're going to point you to some of them. But before we do that, we want to do the most important thing that we can do, which is to pray. And to pray not just a prayer of thanksgiving for all that has been done, but a prayer of hope that there is a day coming when the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the face of the earth like the waters cover the sea. And that glory will be of a kingdom that is marked by peace, and by justice, and by grace. And it will be all of those things. It will remake the world. It will restore the world. That kingdom is coming. It's the kingdom that led Dr. King to say something like, the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And it allowed him to live a sacrificial life in word and deed, to be a person who was willing to walk in the way of Jesus, even when it was unsettling to the culture and costly to him personally. And so we want to pray for that hope and pray that the Lord would characterize it. And so I want to pray, and then I want to invite Antonia, if you'll pray with us, and then we'll give you some resources that maybe you can follow through on. Father, we confess God, that in many ways it is far easier and far more convenient for us to live as if everything is good for us, everything is good for everybody. And that is not true. That is not true. God, I pray that where there is spiritual complacency and complicity in my heart, that you would make me aware of those places and that you would lead me in the path of repentance by your kindness. I ask you, Lord, that you would continue to restore to the church a moral compass that is different from the compass of the world, a moral compass that is characterized by justice, peace, righteousness, and grace, by the holiness of God and by his unconditional love, by truth and by mercy. God, we beg of you that you would do this in our moment, in our age, that we would be awakened to be people who follow in the way of Jesus, even when that's costly to us personally, and even when it's unsettling to the world around us. God, we believe that your kingdom is better than the false kingdoms of this world, and we acknowledge and confess that there have been times where we have become placid, we have become satisfied by false empires and false kingdoms. I know that I have, and I pray, God, that you would break through the idols of our heart, and that you would show us, walk with us as we attempt to walk in your ways by the power of the Spirit. We pray these things in the name of Christ.
God, I thank you for the life and ministry and witness of Dr. King. And I pray that even as we just begin a little bit of time to consider his legacy, I thank you for the ways in which you've been able to reflect on your word, and that is strong and sure, and to reflect on your purposes for the creation and for your people, and that all of this, even in the hardest of conversations, all points to you, that you are good and holy and faithful. And so I do pray that as a people you be rooted in your character and in your presence, and that we would be compelled to participate. I thank you that you have invited us in to participate in the story, and that we get to show up and image you in how we are blessing to those around us. And so I do pray that you would reveal, but as you reveal, that you would restore, and that in that we would be a people who resolve to live lives that are countercultural, that are costly for all of the right things that are aligned with your will in your kingdom. I ask in particular for the children who maybe heard the story or who are growing up in this time, and God, would you just give a special, through this generation, would we see just early fruit even of a generation that is pursuing you, who wants to see your righteousness, your justice, made manifest in our community. For all these things, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So maybe you're thinking, hey, I'd like to follow through on this. I just learned some things today and I want to know a little bit more. Well, there's a few different things that you could look at. I'll give you a few and then Antoinette can point you to some that may be good for your kids. If you're looking for just a really very easy thing to jump into, you could watch Selma, which is a movie that is incredibly well produced, and you can find that on Amazon. If you're looking for something that tells the history of just black men and women in the life of this country, which is certainly pertinent for reflecting on the life and legacy of Dr. King, you could look at Many Rivers to Cross. It's free on Amazon Prime. It's an incredible PBS documentary. And I promise there are things there, many things there that you do not know, and it would be worth considering. You could check out, if you're trying to figure out, like, okay, what would Dr. King's voice maybe sound like today? You could watch The 15th on Netflix. And if you wanted to do something just about hearing his voice in his own words, you could check out Letter from a Birmingham Jail. It's free. If you just Google Letter from a Birmingham Jail, you're going to find a free PDF of it. You don't have to pay for any of these things that I just told you about. So, Antoinette, are there any resources you might say are aimed towards kids or families?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'll just hold up the book. I mean, I know today is MLK Day, but there's the rest of the week, and your kids will probably be responsive to bedtime stories. So this one, I Am Martin Luther King Jr., is great for younger kids. For kids that are slightly older, this book is fantastic. It's called My Brother Martin, and it's actually written by Dr. King's sister, and it's the only book that's written by an immediate family member. And so it has some really just incredible truths, and it's very kid-friendly, but again, more for elementary age kids. it's something else. You know, I am biased, but I grew up in Atlanta, and so I've had the opportunity to go to the MLK Museum there. And so because everything's digital with COVID and all of that, I'd encourage you to go on the website and see that they might just be able to talk through some of the pictures and images, and there's lots of family stories there. And then last, it's not kids related, but just in terms of, you know, the last year, we didn't talk a ton about this, but we talked about lots of things. That's okay. But just the unique witness of the Black church in America. And there's lots of questions right now about how can we be this, you know, this voice that is distinctive from our culture, and the legacy of the Black church is certainly one worth considering. And so I know you've referenced this before, Kyle, but Jude 3 Project has putting out some incredible resources. And so I know I've gotten lots of questions from parents about, like, how do I incorporate more just people and, you know, of color and Black history. And so Jude 3 has some really incredible resources that I'd encourage you to check out. So
that's great. Yeah. And Jude 3, for all of your Insta fan people, if you're on Instagram, you may be watching. Oh, if you're watching this, you might be on Instagram because we posted it there. But go follow Jude 3 because they are putting incredible resources out there, and not just concerning on the conversation about race. I mean, they're doing incredible resources about how to study the Bible, about how to talk about the doctrine of God with other people. I mean, it's just really good stuff. And I would strongly encourage you to check it out. Jude 3 Project, they've done fantastic stuff. So listen, hey, thank you for watching this. And thank you for sticking with it. Maybe consider sharing it. And not because we need any of our Mosaic brand out there, but just because there's going to be a lot of people today who want to kind of soft pedal the conversation. And we want to make sure that people understand Dr. King's vision was uniquely Christian. And it's tied to kingdom implications of the gospel. And that's good news, because God's kingdom is coming and we're hungry for it. We want it now. Not now.
More. Just a little bit more, or a lot more.
Yeah, a little bit more. Hey, bless you guys. Thank you for jumping on. And thanks for jumping on with me.